Join us live as we broadcast worldwide, Wednesday evenings, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, only on Beyond the Flat Earth.
The popular flat earth model with the sun and moon doing circles is impossible, and so we have to keep looking for another model.
Hey everyone, this event Skeptic. I'm here with Jason from Awake Souls, and tonight we're going to discuss the map and model that we think shapes the face of our reality. How you doing today?
I'm doing well, Ronnie. How are you?
I'm good. Just doing whatever I can and just trying to share everything that I found, you know?
Yeah, we just did this last night.
Reference point.
Yeah. Yeah, if anyone missed that, it's check it out.
Yeah, there's so much material that we you know, off air, we talk about this. There's so much material. To just go like once a week, it feels like it would take too long to get it out there. And we're like trying to keep it to like 2 hours and under so that, you know, these are easier shows to digest. In fact, we'd like to keep it even less than that, but have more of them. So sort of bite size, chew them up a little so that, no, we understand that everybody out there has got busy lives, but we think this is really important information, so we're trying to figure out ways to get it to you that is easy to digest.
Yeah, that's you couldn't have said it any better, like more palatable.
Yeah.
Or simple.
Simple.
Simple just works, right? Usually.
Yeah, well, that's the idea behind that flowchart that I started, and I got to show it a little bit yesterday. I cleaned it up a little bit today, and I really want to sort of emphasize what I'm going to be doing with this flowchart. And let's see here.
Yeah, I've got you presenting.
Can you see this now?
One sec. Nope, not yet. Yep.
All right.
Bam. Perfect. Thank you. I'm just going to mute for a second. So yeah. You come in nice and clear when I mute.
Okay. Yeah. So, this is what I'm calling the direct path to simulation realization. It has a little bit of a flow to it, but I messed it up. And so what this is a number of different levels, and I'm going to zoom in here. The first thing that I'm saying is that what we experience in this world, as far as what we think is reality, is input data from five different senses, and I've got a sixth one sort of hooking in from the side there, intuition. And I think it's pretty demonstrable that intuition is one of the inputs. But we're looking at that information coming in sort of through a pipeline, our five senses on this human body. And our consciousness, this is a non-physical thing, filters the data stream and writes the narrative of our life. So we're looking at that data, and there's a narrator in our head that's assembling it all. And it has to do with the way you see the world. So this is where you can think of like, how much light a person has, how bright they are. You know, this has to do with levels of spirituality. So people that are living lives of anger and fear and regret and stuff like that, they see the world through a totally different lens. So when they see the data coming in, the way they write the story, the narrative, is from a negative perspective. And then there's people that see the world in a positive light. So when they see that data coming in, the narration to the story looks nice. So, you know, our consciousness is a filter. And so this level one, the accepted worldview, the first thing I have here is education indoctrination. And so obviously when we're born to our parents, they're going to teach us the first part of our lives. Every question that we ask, they're going to be the source of our answer. And then we end up in school systems, and then we have hired people that tell us what we're supposed to believe. And that curriculum, it's very specific, both from what we get from our parents and from the institutions. Our parents can only share with us what they were taught. And then the institutions, they get to assemble a curriculum, but because the institutions were there before our parents, they were taught by them as well. So what we see as reality is it's been filtered before we were born in this world. So we can't see with our own eyes what the truth really is. It has to come from a different source. And so now I have this split from what I showed before. This is a little bit of a break. I added duality. And so I've got non-duality here and duality over here. And so this is a split. And then there's a red path, and then there's a green path. And I know duality is a tough topic for a lot of people because, you haven't looked into it. You know, I hadn't. Growing up in the Western world, we really don't know much about the Eastern religions, unless if you spend a bunch of time looking into them and studying them and researching. I had no idea what the Buddha taught up until I started looking into it. And so there's those Eastern religions that deal with non-duality. Not all of them do. A couple of them do. Now, non-duality itself, there is no religion that teaches it. It's not Buddhism. It's not Hinduism. It's not Taoism. But there are people from within those religions that teach non-duality. But there is no organization that teaches non-duality. So we're taught to believe in duality, and that really boils down to a belief in the opposites. This is one of Satan's core tricks, that it's like the yo-yo in space, or the water droplet floating through air that they're paddling back with ping pong paddles. This is just another parlor trick that our minds have been fooled with, to believe in duality, and that is a belief in the opposites. And so I guess I'm going to dive into this just a little bit. I got to drink something. Sorry about that.
Yeah, I'm totally enjoying the start. This is great.
Yeah, so the belief in the opposites, this is a little bit of a big topic. Maybe you can join me for this, Ronnie. So what's the most popular opposites that you can think of?
That would have to be, I guess, good and bad, white and black.
Sure, white and black. A lot of the ones that people go to are really reciprocals. They go for up and down, like left and right. You know, hot and cold, things like that. So these aren't actually opposites. We're taught to believe that they're opposites, but I just want to point out to you that they're actually they're either reciprocals or gradients. All the opposites that we can think of, because there's only certain opposites that you ever go to. Because if I ask you what's the opposite of an apple, what would you say?
A pear. No, there is no opposite of it.
And what's the opposite of a television?
Non-television.
Well, I mean, what's the opposite of carpet?
It's an error.
Yeah, they don't have any opposites. Yeah. So, I mean, almost everything, there simply is not an opposite for it. You're trained to go to certain things, which are reciprocals or gradients. And so this good and bad is going to be the most difficult one. It actually falls into the gradient category. But as far as reciprocals are concerned, or 180 degrees is another way that some of these things are expressed. So, you know, the opposite of north is south. Well, the true opposite of north would have to be a non-direction, right? It's like asking what's the opposite of carpet. It has to be non-carpet or non-flooring.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So the opposite of north would have to be a non-direction. So what's a non-direction?
Yeah, there is none.
There is none. So south is actually just 180 degrees of north, and east is 180 degrees of west. And then so other things are reciprocals. If you look at numbers, if you put 3 over 1, okay, it's actually 3 if you look at it mathematically when you put 3 over 1. But if you put 1 over 3, it's 1/3. So is 3 the opposite of 1/3?
No.
No, they're not opposites. So yeah, like our up and down, they're just reciprocals or 180 degrees. So it's the explanation for all the opposites that you can think of that really seem like they're opposites. Check to see if it's a reciprocal. Check to see if it's 180 degrees. So then the rest of the opposites all fall into the category of gradients. And so a lot of people go to like light and dark as opposites, right?
Yeah, that's a big one.
But there is only light.
Yeah, well, I guess I could add into here good and evil, because even Lucifer was created from the father that we were.
Yeah, so good and evil, that's, I was going to go do that one last. It's the toughest one. But so light is as far as just like light in a room, like you turn on a light, there is only one thing, only one variable, and that is light. Now what happens is when there isn't light, we've come up with a term for it, and we've called it darkness. But darkness is not a different separate thing. It's the absence of light. Okay, so there's only one thing, but it's there in varying quantities. And then when it's completely gone, we've created a label for it. But the label doesn't mean that it exists. It doesn't exist. So darkness is the absence of light. There's only one variable. So there's not two things. There's not lightness and darkness, like duality suggests. Mm-hmm. There is only light, and it comes in varying degrees. You can do the same thing with electricity, the amount of current on a wire. You can have tons of electricity on it. And then, you know, with like some sort of rheostat or something like that, you can turn it down, bring down your voltage, You can make it super, super small. And then when it's zero, there's no electricity. Okay? There's not like a anti-electricity, no opposite of electricity. It's just, it's there, or it's there in varying degrees. But if there is none of it, there's no electricity. That's not an opposite. Okay. So then the last one, is good and evil. This is the toughest one. You need to understand that there's only one variable there. There's not two. There's not good and evil. It's only all good. It's all light. It's all love. Everything is love. That's what the scriptures tells us. And it's there in varying quantities. So when there's the maximum amount of light and love there, we call it Christ consciousness. And then when you turn it down and down and down, you'll pass through the saints, you'll pass through, you know, the elect, you'll pass through the faithful flock, and then eventually you'll get to a point where it transitions into what we call evil. And this is what Einstein refers to as relativity. Everything appears relative when you're on that gradient line. Okay, so some people are going to say that, well, this is good, and another person is going to look at it and say that's evil. That's different people's perspectives on it. But so there's just a gradient there of love, and then like water changes qualities at different temperatures. So it was at 212 degrees Fahrenheit, it boils. 32 degrees, it freezes, but it's always water. But it appears in different states at different temperatures. So the good, the Christ consciousness, that's like a steam. And then in the middle, the normal people like us, that's the water. And then the what we call evil in the world is like the ice. All right, so that was a quick run through in the opposites, because that is really those little parlor tricks that Satan's using right there. That's what gets people to believe in duality, and that separates things. So I'm going to zoom in here a little bit, and you can see here under duality, I wrote belief that everything is separate. It means, you know, you and I, Ronnie, were completely, completely separate. But the non-duality path, it means realizing those parlor tricks that Satan's using, understanding that and applying that knowledge in the rest of the choices that you make in your life, there's a belief that everything is connected. And so these are two different paths, because when I zoom back out, this path comes off of education indoctrination, and just about everybody believes in duality. Okay. So then this is a filter that you're processing everything that you think about in your life through. So you think about it through the aspect of duality. And then, so the atheist sees himself completely separate, and he has no creator to answer to. He's in pure separation. The agnostic is sort of in between, doesn't know what to think. And then the person in religion, this is following that path of education indoctrination, just like the school institutions have, you know, taught us everything. But then when it comes to our understanding of the creator, these religions have acted, you know, just like the colleges of this world, as far as educating people. And this is all done through dualistic thinking. So then if you follow this green path, because remember, this is the direct path to simulation realization. So bing, we got green. Here we got green. On green, we went through non-duality, and now we're at spirituality. And so here, I've got written personal seeking of knowledge from the non-physical realm. So this is what like you and I are doing. We seek knowledge of this non-physical realm that we can't see it, we can't touch it, we can't hear it, can't taste it. I guess we do have intuition, but because we know that there is a spiritual realm, and so we do personal seeking without being told what to do. We just seek, and there is a red path branching off from spirituality back to religion, because there are some of those Eastern religions that teach non-duality, and then it shoots right back to religion. Even though there's not a specific religion teaching non-duality, people tend to end up in, you know, like a Buddhist or Hindu or a Tao type religion. And then they have people telling them what to believe again. So,
same.
Yeah.
Indoctrination.
Mm-mm.
Education.
So then if you pass on through spirituality, and you're seeking the non-physical realm, and you learn about what most people call Jesus, referred to as Yahawashi, the son of Yahawah, the creator. When you learn about him, you know, we learn about him through the Bible. And it explains. Yeah, it explains that all. And so then you either believe it or you don't. And so if you don't believe it, you're not a Christian. And if you do believe it, you are. If you act in accordance with it as well. So then this branches off here, because at this point, through these filters, there's all these different topics that we've been indoctrinated, that our five senses have told us about. And you see there, this green path goes through the globe Earth. But so at this top level, the level one, you know, we're told that dinosaurs, or I'll zoom in, show you what these say. Dinosaurs existed, and we fill our cars up with them. Did you know that, Ronnie?
Yeah, actually, our whole society is powered on the bones of the dinos. Everything.
Everything's powered off them. Then, yeah, 9/11. 19 Arab hijackers flew planes into the Twin Towers, Pentagon, and the field. That's the official narrative. Mandela effect. People have bad memories. Evolution. Humans evolved from monkeys. But keep in mind, this is what the atheists, agnostics, and people of religion believe. In the globe Earth, the Earth is a spinning ball traveling through space. Then there's the 66 book Bible only. That only the 66 book canon of the Bible is acceptable to study. There are contrails. When you look up there and you see all those X's and planes traveling sideways, that is water vapor condensed at certain altitudes. And then atomism, the ancient Greeks believed they were made up of atoms that are almost infinitely empty space, and that they were correct. So, how long ago were the ancient Greeks?
3,000 years, 2,500, supposedly.
Yeah. And they, out of all the different scientific theories, that theory, they nailed it back then in ancient Greece. Nailed it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Once they made the electron microscope and the nuclear neutron quantum microscope, it turns out that what those guys in ancient Greece were talking about, where they were exactly right. And then math, it's considered to be a perfect language, absolutely flawless. Math is perfect all the time, and humans are failures. So the question is do you stop there? Is that where you stop at? Because if you go to level 2, which is conspiracy, you're going to be called a tinfoil hatter. All right. If you believe in anything in level 2, you're a tinfoil hatter. Well, guess what? Ronnie and I are tinfoil hatters.
Yes, I am. I'll never go back on it. Actually, sorry, I shouldn't say never, because that's non-dualistic type of a comment.
So what I've got here,
irrational. Sorry, go ahead.
That's right. What I've got here is, so this is a firewall. This is where all the people that follow what they've been educated in, this is where they stop. It's a firewall. You go through it. Level 2 conspiracy, there are people saying that dinosaurs are not ancient, that they are not millions of years old, but existed during the time humans have existed. Now, at this level of conspiracy, I'm only 1% with this level 1 conspiracy. Where do you stand on that, Ronnie? Okay, 0.5%.
0.5, yeah.
All right. I guess I'll go horizontal here.
Wait. Dinosaurs never existed.
Well, see, that's actually level 3 conspiracy down here. Okay. I'm 99% on that.
There were large animals, and maybe there was beasts, the oceans in the field, but I don't think there was Tyrannosaurus Rexes running around with Stegosauruses. I'm sorry.
No, the reason why I'm 1% on dinosaurs not ancient is because there's some scriptures that talk about some beasts that I don't know if they were here physically or not. You know, the behemoth and what was the other one? Leviathan.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if those creatures were here or not. So if they were, maybe there's some skeletons of those. But yeah, Tyrannosaurus Rex and all that, like, the toys and the movies and stuff like that. Yeah, that's, I'm not with that.
Yeah, me neither. So yeah, keep on going. Sorry.
Yeah, that's all right. I'm going to be asking you some questions on these.
Okay.
So, you know, the 9/11, the level 2 conspiracy is, that it was a false flag. It was a false flag orchestrated by governments to justify war and stricter surveillance on the general population. Now, this is another one like the dinosaurs, where I'm at 1% because I do believe in a level 3 on this one. I'll tell you what level 3 is. That 9/11 is a hoax. So that'll let you know where I'm going with it.
Well, as far as I know, I'm going to have to say it's a hoax as well, pretty much so. I don't know who perpetrated it yet. I don't think you ever will.
Right.
But I won't rest upon cavemen, you know, taking down skeleton buildings. You know, there's a lot of issues that we were really fooled in. Like the illusion was David Copperfield type.
Yeah, so if you were... What would you say for the idea that it was just a false flag and that there was no higher level hoax to it? What would you put for a percentage there?
I'd probably say 2%.
Okay. And then, so yeah, the level 3 conspiracy, And so let me show this. The level three conspiracy is a conspiracy within a conspiracy. And so I feel that 9/11, yeah, see, now I'm going vertical, but I feel that 9/11 was a hoax and that no airplanes were used and nobody died. So not many people go where I'm going with nobody died. But what I have is I have a context where if I look at this, I haven't filled this all out yet.
Yeah, it's but a work in progress with the viewers, but
once,
right?
Once I've filled this all out and I see how many times all these level two conspiracies have gone to a level three conspiracy where it goes from a false flag to a hoax, it creates a context. And that's where my confidence comes from. It doesn't come from, it comes from the continuity, not the fact that I was there in New York and witnessed the whole thing firsthand and know for certain myself that nobody died. That's not the position that I'm taking. There's a lot of evidence. And so each one of these things has reference points. So, people are gonna take it the opposite side of this. They're gonna think, yeah, people did die. So as I put material out there that references the reasons why I feel that nobody died, I'll be adding reference points there. Okay. And then if somebody out there has actual evidence that somebody died and they can present that evidence, then we'll add that, and I'll change my position.
I was just going to say, I just wanted to repeat again that, you know, everything that we're discussing and all these topics are subject to movement and repose. And I'm going to continue.
That's what these numbers are.
Well, I'm going to continue.
They're going up and down.
You know, I'll throw a cherry out to the listening audience. From the future or the past, depending on where you think time lives. Okay, so I've seen footage, whether or not it was real or not. I'm about 98%. It was a cameraman running into the tower. So they had a demolition guy there. He had his walkie-talkie. You got to clear it out. They were clear. There was nobody in the building. And you got to imagine if the entire media and the entire population has no idea that something is about to go down, the advantage is so far skewed to the perpetrator that it's almost 100% no way you could doubt that what we're discussing here is true. So the thing I would like to know is where are the people that were there that day that, you know, witnessed the carnage? Because like you were saying before, and you've done an extensive search, there's not much of anything really, right? Except for like false flags and hoax videos.
Yeah. yeah. As far as 9/11 is concerned, I've looked for just a single picture of even a company party from within like their offices at the Twin Towers. You know, these were prominent offices. You would think that there'd be some of that information. I can't find any of it. I don't know if it's been scrubbed, but I see no evidence of that. It seems like it was a very elaborate Freemason hoax, an illusion again, another magic trick.
I couldn't agree with you more. And I'm 98% on that.
Alrighty. All right. So I don't know if you want to fill this all out now together, or if you want to do some other stuff. But so if you want to be quicker about it,
the direct path to symbolization realization.
Yeah, let's go back to the path. So that was a. That just demonstrates what we're doing with this right there for the audience, because this is all going to be filled out by us, and we're going to stand by these positions. So as we do shows where you can call in, we'll take your call or take your question from the chat. We want to do this all live and work together on this kind of stuff. So as we fill in these reference points, as soon as somebody gets stuck with something that we're saying, we can go directly to that point and we can address the information that's in those reference points. And so we'll get this all filled out.
It's great. I love it.
Yeah, coming through globe Earth, when you hit the conspiracy level, it becomes flat Earth. Let me zoom in on this. So the Earth is flat and motionless. Now this is scriptural again. This is running through the Christian filter of the canon. Even without going to extra biblical books. So my position on it is a definite 100%, and you've said that your position is 100%. The Earth is flat and motionless.
Yeah, Zeisenzeck.
And then, so this is the level 2 conspiracy. Now we're going to pass through to the level 3 conspiracy within a conspiracy.
Now this, I already have an update.
Nice.
I got a comment. Somebody was saying that it was crazy, the notion that you could have, you know, they thought that level 2, there was the revealing of the truth. They didn't understand how there could be a conspiracy inside of a conspiracy.
Yeah. Well, that's what this flowchart is for, is to show you how there can be a conspiracy within a conspiracy, because it's not just flat Earth. You'll see if I back this out. You know, 9/11, there's a conspiracy within the conspiracy. Most 9/11 people just think of it as a false flag, that the government orchestrated this in order to be able to go to war and to be able to implement stricter surveillance on the population.
Yeah,
that is the typical understanding of 9/11. But there are those, and I think there's quite a few within the flat Earth community that are aware of this, that 9/11 was actually a hoax, and that people didn't die. It was a big magic trick.
Well, you know, I just wanted to add in there that putting the ownership back onto the people that go and kill for these collective memories is what they want to do. They want that's the trick that the evil has. It wasn't me. You know, it's like the kid handing off, you know, the stolen bubble gum. You know, you hold it. You know, it's people have to understand that the deception lies within the trickery, that you don't understand that you've woken up to the truth. Oh, you know that it was the government that flew the buildings, the stand down and Pearl Harbor. But then you have to realize that there's a conspiracy inside of that conspiracy where they've set up a false narrative. So this is definitely beneficial for me and for my subscribers to be paying attention.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So then, you know, the level 3 conspiracy within a conspiracy is that the popular flat Earth model is impossible. It doesn't work. And so what I've got here is the equinox, sunrise, and sunset angles prove the sun and moon are not doing circles. All right. So the position that I take on this is 100%. And you've said, Ronnie, 100%, right?
Oh, yeah. 100%.
100%. And so these reference points right here, this is going to be where like every one of the videos that we have right now go.
Reference point.
It's how you can do it. It's a flat two-dimensional map that if you take that thing and you wrap it onto a sphere in a 3D modeling program, you know what? It turns out looking like the globes we have in the classroom. So it means that if you mentally project yourself into three-dimensional space, from that two-dimensional map, it ends up looking like a globe. So that's the reason why the globe seems and looks to behave correctly, even though we know that there's no curvature. So that's why we believe that this is a simulated world, along with there's much more context. So you can see here, we didn't cover Mandela effect tonight here, but this is one of the paths. You've got it stops up at the top with people thinking that they have bad memories, but once you get to the level 3 of Mandela effect here, and I have here changes to physical reality are being made using quantum computers, CERN, and witchcraft. So I don't know what it is, but there is something that's altering the code, that it's changing things in our reality. And once you come to that conclusion, I'm at 99% on that. That is another path into the level 4 complete paradigm shift of this being a simulated world. So there's going to be other paths that tie in as well. I like the flat Earth one, because we've got what we call physical observable evidence to go by. Mandela, you get stuck with having to defend your memory, and people won't believe that you have a good memory.
Well, see, that's the answer. Is when you realize that it's a simulation, then you can completely understand that the Mandela effect is more than likely. It's probable.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, in the scriptures, even predict it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'd make every man a liar, but the Holy Logos will always be the truth.
Yeah. So that's first draft right there. I just sort of shuffled things around today and got it into a format that I was semi-happy with. I'm sure it's going to be evolving along the way. The thing that we're going to be doing is adding all of the level 2 conspiracies. So that's everything. That's every single thing in this world that we've been told is one way. That they've been lying, and it's another way. So this chart might end up getting to be like miles wide.
Yeah. Well, it could take, 20 years.
Yeah, we've got our work cut out for us.
Mm-hmm. But, that's why I'm happy that we're doing this. And I think that so far, so good. You're on the... And I guess if you want, I can go into the map and model.
That'd be great.
So I guess this is a call for a reference point.
Reference point.
I'm going to unpresent you. And I'll get this ready. So everybody, everything that I'm going to say is subject to questioning, investigation, movement, and repose.
Yep.
Okay. Great. Thank you very much for that presentation, too. It was was great. Hopefully, this is coming through clear. Can you see?
I can see.
Okay. I'm just going to start off with some of the issues with the... as equidistant equidescent map. And again, so along with the winter solstice and the bi-monthly moon due east to due west rise set paths, the spinning fixed stationary disk Earth just doesn't work. And I'm going to keep repeating this again and again. As you can see there, that shiny star there, it's not setting, it's circling. So this is one of the first reference points for the sky, it's the sky is divided along the equator, and this is not only known, but if you can go there, you can do your own tests. This doesn't take very long to verify. The sun travels due east and due west.
Well, you can verify it with a star trail video at the equator, right?
Yeah. Well, okay. So what this projection is, the AE is unipolar. So it's only has a one pole, but we know that Earth has two. So the stars in the north, they do what we would call the Coriolis effect. Okay. Now it's not happening in the clouds, but it's happening in the motions of the heavenly bodies. So this doesn't work because down the center is a division line. So the days were divided, the years, the months, the weeks, and time. It was divided. So if the sun was circling 3,000 miles above, the rise and set patterns would never, ever equal a negative path. So the sun would continue just like this. It wouldn't go below the horizon. And just a quick skip ahead, the sun and the moon are both observed within your 3-mile circle of sight. Mm-hmm. We'll get to that later. But the most interesting piece of evidence here is that if the sun and the moon were circling over the round circular path that's proposed, three different observers throughout the face of the Earth would all see different phases and sides of the moon. And in reality, everybody sees the same one, except it's like looking through a coin.
So, that image right there, if you can just like really get people to understand what they're looking at in that image, those are cameras. There's a place down in South America. There's one that looks like Toronto, man. It looks like you. And then out in the middle of Africa. All right. So based on these latitudes on the AE map, you see how you would be seeing these different sides of the moon from those different positions.
It's a map killer, right?
It is.
And, I'm not a bearer of bad news because I believe the face of the Earth is flat. But yeah. I'm not going to hang my hat on anything that isn't true. If I'm willing to die, I'm going to show people the evidence of why I would say that, because
it's right there.
What I believe is true is true. So as you can see, when the moon turns here, as it's a globe in the sky, but there. Okay, so we got Africa, South America, and North America. And as you can see, they all have different phases. This would be a full moon. This is impossible in reality because the rendering of the moon and the sun and all the heavenly bodies has a fixed, designed path.
Mm. And I know that those words are hard for people to understand. We're gonna keep pointing it out the best we can. But if you look at these camera angles, you'll realize that from those different positions, that's not what's happening. The moon's not doing circles over us.
It's literally impossible. And the reason why is in the simulation rendering, like you have been harping on with the rainbow effect. We could call it the simulation effect, really, because the simulation's boundaries are set to the observer's center point, and it's interactive and immersive. So reality is just like a video game that they're trying to create now. Well, probably do have. So
yeah,
the moon is rendering on its. So okay, I'm going to go on. I'm going to move on with the presentation here. The moon is doing its path, right? So again, so this would be the circle in the south. So like I keep harping on people at the winter solstice, the moon, the stars, and the sun would have to be doing a figure A. They're going completely the wrong direction, opposite, or 180.
The moon does it twice a month. The sun we have from the autumn equinox to the spring equinox to observe it. The way it's curving in the wrong direction there.
Yeah,
we only have that half a year that we can check it out with the sun. But the moon we can check it out twice a month.
And then from here it's going like this. You know, it's almost like this is designed to take people back to, you know, really what we need is this exact picture and then flipped upside down. If you want to try and use this circling sun and moon, you're going to have the opposite effect happening below this sheet. And, you know, that's an impossibility because it's more absurd to have someone walking on the ceiling of the underneath of the earth than so this definitely doesn't work.
Oh, and the ideas that I've heard as far as the lensing effect and stuff like that being the source of this, I'm sorry, you haven't looked at it and studied the angles if you believe that that's possible. Mm-hmm.
So what everybody at home can do and everyone on the face of the earth can do is they can check their angles and the shadows that the sun casts by putting a stick in the ground.
And, everybody's got a stick, right?
You know, making a straight line due east to due west and aligning, you can align it with Polaris in the north and Sigma Octantis in the south. And you could tell for yourself the path that's happening. So I'd like to say it's sinusoidal. There's a lot of occultism of the truth. And people need to understand that they have to have their filters out when they're researching. So I guess if everyone here is obviously seeing the hieroglyphs in Egypt, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it kind of does like almost a snake-like figure here. And I don't hear too many people talking about the sky and the fact that this actually matches the sinusoidal pattern. But I'll continue on here. So proof number one that the Mercator map and navigational coordinational maps that we have are truth is the path here of the planets, well, the wandering stars and the other heavenly bodies. You see this clearly on screen, Jay?
I do.
Okay, so you've seen this before, right?
Yeah, you've showed it to me.
Yeah, you know what you're looking at, right? So I guess this is the ecliptical path in the year as the planets, you know, that indoctrination system again, as the heavenly bodies, this would basically be their dance. This is a year broken up from the ground, measuring up with the sky. And the white line in the center is your equator, and it matches up with the celestial equator. And you also have your celestial axis, which aligns from Polaris to the south to Sigma Octantis. And you need four cardinal directions to have a functional environment, Earth, reality, the rendering system. It's basically like a symphony that just marches on through time. So again here, as you can definitely notice, this sinusoidal style type pattern that I'm repeating, I'm just going to continue on here. So you can also get these sinusoidal patterns with the hourly measurements with your genome. Not only that, but we could tell the time using these very simple methods anywhere on Earth. So the sun is proof number two. The observable motions match basically what we can see. So if I go to the map, I guess I'll go to the star chart, this one here. We're seeing the same pattern. And what I suspect is that the Masons do everything opposite. So this is probably upside down.
It's probably upside down, yeah.
What do you think of that?
Oh, yeah, I've thought of that, that it's probably upside down.
So I guess I could continue then.
I don't know. We've been using it like this, but as soon as we had a little bit of evidence to flip it around, I'd flip it around.
Well, yeah, I have seen some. If you do a search on the real map of the Earth or whatever, you're going to find definitely people in Australia and living in the South. I've had a crusade that said that everything should be upside down, and they put everything into perspective from their position. But for me, the outside is the same as the in, and the inner is the same as the outer. Like, I make the two one. And basically what I mean by that is a way to explain this is this from east to west is one day. It's divided.
One day.
And this has to be so, or you don't have any time system. You have to have a start and an end. The non-dualistic style thinking will say, well, there's always, a never beginning or a never ending.
But right.
In my opinion, they're wrong. You need a fixed reference point for a beginning and an end. So this is what I believe, and I'd like anyone to prove me wrong. So if you're standing on the corners or any other position on this map, you are entirely or in truly connected to all the other outside points of the map. So the only thing is you can't time travel from here. Like, it still takes the same duration that it would take you one day to cross the path of this map, right?
Well, there is the interesting thing that we were talking about. Like, if you were to start out in Sydney, Australia, and fly towards Hawaii, so if you're flying and it's today, when you get there and cross that line, all of a sudden, you're going to change your watch and you're going to say, it's the day before. Is it day at? Before. The day before or day after? Before.
Before.
Day before.
This, if you go this way, it would be you go from 24th to the 25th.
Yeah.
And what's interesting about it is that the pattern in the path would in effect cause the giant obstruction we see in the dateline, and it kind of explains it almost to a T. Now, I'm not an AutoCAD expert, but this is subject for debate, and I still am hearing crickets from the dissenter. Where are the debaters?
Yeah, we're the people that want to help us with AutoCAD too. We want your help.
So now, so we've got Eastern and Western Antarctica. So it's divided into two.
It is. And you've seen the maps that divide it too, right?
Yeah. It's impossible not to hide that now. So the other things that I'd like to bring up is this map has four corners and four winds. And basically, it speaks for itself. Now, we haven't quite had time yet to discern the jet streams and airflow, but I'm gonna guess that.
Yeah, I do know that, like, they're typhoons and stuff, don't they? They come in and they hit Japan and the Philippines, like.
Totally. I'm gonna guess that they're gonna replicate and duplicate.
Come in, bam, hit there
like this, and come through, and then. You're going to have westerly winds that come down like this, and they're going to meet. Basically, it's like a wake. And I can go on to the next slide of what I got here to show is basically, these are like a picture or an X-ray of the sun every day for a year. Okay, so
whoa.
Yeah, well, if people don't understand, I'm just going to keep bringing it up. Again, you have the equator and the magnetics and the path and the wake and the motions of reality. Right? You understand.
Well, I'm looking at that for the first time. I'm trying to soak it in.
Okay, I jump ahead. So yeah, it's a snapshot, you know.
Where's the continents on there?
Well, you could overlay this over the Mercator, basically.
That's what I was thinking.
Well, that's what it is. It's again. So this is the coordinates of the stars.
Yeah.
The last one was the sun, and they all match and fit, and you know you can properly navigate without needing what would be known as true north and magnetic north. All of that is done away with.
Whose picture is that of the X-rays of the sun?
I can't remember the name of the scientific researcher and photographer that did it. I'll put it in the description bar below.
Yeah, I'd like to check in on that.
It probably, a lot of the stuff has NASA and, you know, Berkeley and a bunch of other technical institutes attached to it. But like I said, you got to filter through things and
exactly
decide for yourself what matches reality.
Well, the fact that they put that image out and it matches the map almost identically is interesting for sure.
And so if you're trying to counter distort this Mercator system map, all you're doing basically is widening and shrinking the sinusoidal wave. It never changes, this path. And basically the motions, they speak for themselves. So I'm going to keep trying to show people what's going on here. So the sun has its rising point in the east. It mounts up. And we're going to be able to observe this as it takes its descent. And I believe that these are the reasons why it appears to be setting and rising throughout its 24-hour path, right? It does these motions. But you also have to remember that this map is doing away with magnetics. So it's also positioning the ley lines with, you know, what I believe is the correct coordination of the map of this is all of the movements of the motionly bodies in the heavens.
Mm-hmm.
This is the chart. And I, you know, good job, Bob and Cammy on Globusters. I do have to say that they were showing images similar to these, but I wish they could have explained a little bit further now. So as you can see this path here, it basically reaches both sides and it matches down here on the bottom.
So, mm-hmm.
You know, it best describes a division. And I guess the next point I'd like to make real quick is all the evidence of the ancient sailors and folklore of this great place in the north with the waters or the giant mouth that, you know, eats the water and it spits it out in the south. And there is many documentaries that show that water does pump from the south, and there is a type of a pump system going on here. Is this anything that you haven't heard?
No, I've heard about the pumping, the water's flowing in and out. I've heard about big whirlpools and mountains and maybe the Garden of Eden. So,
yeah,
lots of things running through my head there.
And the Northern Lights, right?
Yeah, the Northern Lights are up there. You get to see those.
Yeah, it totally is. And again, with this map, this is another clip that I have. You know, the title of this map was The Real Map of the World. And it's basically another Mercator with the same system with the, as you can see here, you'd have your celestial axis as it cuts down. Mm-hmm. And again, you have your equator as it comes down and through, and you know it perfectly lines up with all of solar panel mapping telemetry and data. Like they position their satellites due to this, right?
Or their solar panels.
No, oh, sorry, solar panels, satellites.
They're solar panels.
I know. I might be overreaching. And
with the solar panels on the satellites, they have them pointed there too. Just kidding.
So, yeah, I know. It's great. You know, I always wondered that with the Bell Express view, how the satellite managed to stay in the same spot all year. You know, it always kind of got to me. So again, I want to show the ecliptical path. Over 1 year of all the mechanics and motions of the heavenly bodies. And this is measured from the ground and calculated from the Greenwich line. And you can count it in your hours from right to left. And it's basically all there. And I'd like for people to disprove it. I'm going to keep just go on here. Again, Flat Earth Math had a video here. As you can see, the path that he's got shown here, it best describes what we're seeing on this map. It's, you know, you're seeing your circle where my pointer is, or your circle here, or your circle here. And you can even see the movements here. Like, whether or not this is a real or fake image, it's still up for debate, but I'm talking about the motions of the captures. You know, there's no other way. Now the room lines and basically traveling and plane routes, it's still, I haven't done very much research there yet. I don't, how about you?
Yeah, I came across room lines in my math studies, and so it made an instant connection with, because of having looked at the maps, that a room line, when it's on a two-dimensional map and projected onto a sphere, it creates a straight line. And so if a navigator is using a map of the globe and plots a room line, which is what they do for navigation, it's a straight line on the on a flat map. Mm-hmm. Like the oblique Mercator, so it is the direct path. So, yeah. Unfortunately, all the globe earthers have they've been fooled into thinking that they're on a sphere, and so then they have to go through that extra step of adding room lines to get back to what the map really is.
Yeah, and you have to add in, you know, true north and magnetic north to mm-hmm. cover your lie. And as you can see here on the screen. This is another person. Oh, boom. Flat Earth's disproved, you know, because like I said before, you need two maps to describe the Earth at this reality. You need a south projection and a north projection. And you can't tell anyone living in the south that they don't see what they see, because that goes against everything that I stand for. So
us people in the north just don't trust anything anybody in the south says.
Well, I'm sorry, but you know, I do, and I know I trust what I can sight in the sky. Like this picture here, is a no-brainer. This completely again shows the path that I'm explaining in the sky. You see, this would be the equator. This is a snapshot of somewhere along this line, and you can deduce where it is
by based on the tilt of the tunnel.
Yeah, the rise and the set. So if you see the sun rising from your right, traveling left, you're in the south looking north. Okay? And if you see the sun rising from your left,
going up the wall.
Up the wall to the right, you're in the north looking south. And this is completely explained on this map. Okay? So we don't have to go up the wall. Okay? So again, I'm going to explain it again. So as the sun goes down this line twice a year, everywhere on this map can see that the sun is rising due east and setting due west. And it works without fail all of the sundial star.
How many portals are on that map?
Portals.
Yeah.
Well, like I said before, it's
how many
portals?
One, two, three, four, five, six. Six portals, like Enoch.
Those are gates.
Gates, six gates.
There's like many portals, and like I said before,
six gates.
This corner is virtually touching this corner. Imagine zooming in the micro to the macro.
Yeah, they're all touching.
That's right.
It wraps up.
You have to make the outer the same as the inner, and the above the same as the below, or you're never going to find the truth in this earth. So I'm going to keep going with this. I hope people, and by the way, the sky, it's an expanse. I'm willing to say that the rendering of reality isn't up there. It's a void. And a lot of flat earthers that are pulling the, it's a dome. Scriptures say so. I'd like to know how the Savior walks, up it. If anyone's ever tried to climb, a dome, let me know how it goes.
All that high altitude footage that we've been looking at as flat earthers, and no stars, no dome. There's no stars and no dome. And so the word rekia, the Hebrew word that's used in those canonical texts, has been translated firmament, but another meaning for rekia is an expanse. And that to me is the correct translation. We should be using the word expanse, not firmament. It was a mistranslation to use firmament based on all the evidence that we're seeing. So unless if all of a sudden somebody bumps into the dome and we have evidence of a dome, it's an expanse.
So again, I have to concur with you, my good brother. A vast emptiness, an expanse, a void. And like he walked upon the waters, he like so walks upon above us. And again, as I show here, you see a lot of flat earthers like Dr. Zach, and I really appreciate everyone spreading the word and trying to find truth. But if you see this image, do you see the path here?
Yeah.
Okay, I just want to go back to this map again. Do you see anything matching up?
Just the path.
Okay, so I'm going to make this even more clear. I'll say it again. So this path is the path of the heavenly bodies in the sky now. There's the six gates that the sun and the moon traverse through, and the wake that is caused by the heavenly bodies dragging through the expanse is what makes the Coriolis effect of the stars. So you could imagine them being dragged along, like the indoctrination center would propose to you now, actually does, have a piece of truth to it. Mm-hmm. That, like a, in a lake or an ocean with your oars and you cause counter spins all along yetis and.
Yetis, so yeah.
Basically, you're going to have one rotation here, and down here you're going to have an opposite one, mm-hmm. Right? It's really easy. And I'm sorry, but it works. And the globe Earth can't explain many of the things that this map here does. And not only that, when you're searching, this is the best coordinational system for the stars. This is what it's called, the star coordinator. And this map is called the map of the face of the Earth. It's like whether you have it with a conical style projection, or you have it with the one that we're sharing with everyone here, there's no denying that it's what they use. This is how you would navigate. It's everything that lines up with reality. And I'm going to be breaking it down even more, and I'm looking for anybody's comments below and all of the naysayers and disprovers and debunkers, debaters and all. Bring it on. Come on. Let's
make us smarter.
I'm ready for this. Come on.
All they can do is make us smarter. No, some of the comments are so dumb it makes you stupid just to listen to them.
So remember, this would be flipped upside down, right? This mm-hmm. again is the path that's being illustrated. Now, and I guess lastly, I'll touch upon one more thing that I think is relevant. The heavenly bodies are classified to different levels. Okay, the sun, the moon, and the heavenly host of stars. They all have different positions. And I'm going to guarantee, or basically predict, I'd say 99% sure, that any occultation or conjunctions that we see are absolute proofs that this is exactly what we're seeing above in the heavens. So the moon, I believe she would be pretty low, pretty close, rendered closest to our observation points. And you're also going to have Venus and Mercury. So I'm not going to continue on too far with that because I'd like to make sure that I verify the heights and occultation positions. I really appreciate everybody for tuning in, and your presentation was great. I love the flow chart.
Yeah, well, it'll be a way to keep all of this material neat and tidy and easy to access and just easy. It's the direct path to simulation realization. If you just go through those three levels, you'll be there at the fourth, and you'll be where we are, and you can help us out.
We're just a couple carpenters. I'm just a drywall. I just sling gypsum, you know, and I build schools and shopping malls and hospitals and houses. That's what I do, and I build walls, and that's why your flow chart system, it really, really it works with me. It totally does, and I hope that people can understand the direct path to simulation realization. I got simulation realization.
You did the exact same thing I did when I first said it.
Well, you know, I got some scales. some scales with me, and I just like to thank everyone for hanging tight with me through all my spelling mistakes and editing errors, and sometimes I'm not on 4/4 timing, I'm on 7/8, or you know.
I know what you mean.
And that unpredictability and the realization of the simulation is proof in itself, and I'm so thankful that I got to share this time with everyone. I think we were, and I hope everyone can keep on with this because the clock is ticking. And okay, enough with the sound effects. But please, everyone in the chat, I love you very much. All the people out there that are following Yahawashi's way, and please tune in next Wednesday for the Gospel of Thomas. And if you have any plugs to make, Jay, please go ahead.
That's it. I'm excited. Can't wait to go into those scriptures. One super request. If Robert's out there and he hears this, we'd love for you to join us. There's nobody that knows this material better than you. So that would be fun.
Yeah. Well, I put the word out, and I'm really looking forward to reading the word and getting into this extra canonical scripture, because I do believe that the cane or the rod, or you know, your spirit is your measurement of what you take in, and this gospel, I cherish it. So it's going to be great. I basically hope that I did my job today, and I've done my best to share the truth with everyone worldwide.
You are doing it, brother. All right. Well, let's wrap it up, and We'll talk to y'all this next Wednesday.
What if everything we were told was nothing but lies?
What are we? We're the context of all it is, not the content. We're the decision maker as to what reality is. Because we take all the bits and pieces of information and we put the story together in our heads. So, can we use this to discern truth from lies? Can we look at COINTEL information and figure out what is the truth that they're saying?
Join us live as we broadcast worldwide, Wednesday evenings, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, only on Beyond the Flat Earth.